Hey everybody, this is John Marucci. Thank you for joining us for another video. We're coming to you to talk to you today about taking your R-Pod out on its maiden voyage. So this is going to be an R-Pod 101 video for those of you who are just getting an R-Pod, maybe a new one, very exciting time, or a used one. And we're just going to give you some general counsel and tips from our own experience. And in the last couple years, I've actually bought two different R-Pods. So I've got some experience on doing this and taking an R-Pod out on its maiden voyage, do some checkups, make sure everything's going okay. So we're going to come to you with 10 tips today on taking your R-Pod out on its maiden voyage. And at the very end of the video, I've got a bonus tip that may just help you with improving your relationships when you're camping. Okay, so that's going to be at the end of the video. So let's get into this. What's the first tip? So the first thing if you're taking your R-Pod out on its maiden voyage actually occurs before you ever take it out. And that's if at all possible, videotape your walkthrough of your R-Pod. So if you're buying your R-Pod from a dealer, if at all possible you have someone with you with a phone, videotape everything so you have a recording of the initial walkthrough of your R-Pod. And if you can't do that, go up to YouTube and look at these things. Search for these different items that you might be interested in the R-Pod to get used to the various things before you take it out. Okay? But it's a good idea, if possible, to have stuff videotaped. So that's the first one. Videotape your walkthrough. Number two, maiden voyage stuff. Try to camp close by on a little test run. So if you're going to take it out on a maiden voyage, instead of taking it 300 miles away the first time, you might want to take it close by for a night or two nights, maybe a state park nearby or a full camp hookup place, even a KOA that's close by. You might want to try it out. But the main deal is that you want to try a test run before you actually go on a long distance to make sure all the things in the R-Pod are actually working properly. All right, so that's the second thing, camp close by. The third thing, if you're going to do this, a maiden voyage and test run here, try to be a contrarian, okay? And I've made this mistake, by the way. You know, don't go camping your first time you've ever taken the R-Pod somewhere that's extremely busy, like on a Memorial Day weekend or whatnot. Get there on a Friday afternoon when everyone else is showing up, and leave Sunday afternoon when everyone else is hitting the dump station at the same time. So if at all possible, good counsel is to try to be a contrarian. Maybe if you can possibly show up on a Sunday afternoon and camp overnight on a Sunday night. Most people will be departing at that point. You have a lot more space. You won't have to try and back up for the first time when there's a bunch of people around you. Or maybe even use the dump station when there's a bunch of people in line behind you. So if at all possible, be a contrarian. Try to camp at a non-busy time. Or even another idea is even buy an extra night. And this idea is pretty interesting because what you can do is actually buy, say, Sunday night to Monday. And yet, instead of staying overnight, you just leave late Sunday when everyone else is checked out and gone. So you'll have the dump station, everything else to yourself. This is all just to get comfortable with the R-Pod at the dump station and when you're dealing with this. So that's the third one, be a contrarian. Number four, you might want to consider a full hookup campsite, especially if you're anxious about things like backing in, about using the dump station. You have full hookups, you can try all your systems, dump your tanks at the full hookup, and even use your black tank flush. You can flush the tanks out real good. Just get used to all the systems before you go try maybe a state park where you have a bunch of people near you at the dump station, etc. So consider a full hookup. Get used to hooking everything up, hooking up the water, hooking up the hoses to the sewer, etc. That's number four, consider a full hookup area when you're first starting. Okay, number five is really important, and that is practice backing up. So one of the more stressful things if you've never rented or never bought a camper before, especially an R-Pod or any other camper really, is the backing up can be kind of stressful. It's kind of counterintuitive how you back up a trailer, and it can be a little stressful, especially if you're pulling in again at a busy time, a lot of people watching you, and you're trying to fit your camper in a small little slot, and that can be pretty stressful your first time. So you can practice backing up. You go down to the local school when no one's in and go to the parking lot, set up some cones, or just have someone with you and help you guide you in and get used to backing up. It's really a good idea to get confident when you're backing up. The other thing, of course, you can go to a state park when it's not busy and you get a slot where there's not that many people around and you can back up easy enough and, you know, get into your slot and practice a few times. So practice backing up. It's a good idea. You know, it'll get your technique down and also help you communicating, hopefully with someone with you helping you back up. We'll talk about that a little bit later too. So that's the fifth one, practice backing up. Sixth one is allow extra time. Now this is something that I learned really the hard way. You know, I had expectations that I'm going to start getting ready to leave at 3 o'clock in the afternoon and I'll be on the road at 4 o'clock. And it almost never works out. So especially if this is the first time around, you know, it takes a lot longer than you think to get on the road. So if you're thinking that, you know, sundown's at 8 o'clock and you're going to hit the road, you're getting home at 5 and you're going to hit the road at 6 and you're still going to make the campsite an hour away at sundown, you may want to think again, because it always takes a lot more time to leave the house than you think. And it takes a lot more time to set up when you get there than you think, because you could easily be end up setting up in the dark, which is actually, you know, one of our next points we'll talk about in a second. But allow extra time. So make sure you bake an extra time your first time. Maybe leave at 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock, and take the stress off about having to get there really quickly. Okay, the seventh one is arrive well nourished. Don't arrive hungry. Okay, this is something I have a lot of experience with. We've done this too many times. It becomes comical if it wasn't so stressful at the time. But you end up, you get hooked up, you want to get out of town, you get to your place, and you realize you haven't eaten anything. Now it's 6:30, and for some reason you think that you're going to arrive there and be able to eat in 15 minutes, but it never happens that way. So my counsel is don't arrive hungry. If at all, eat before you leave, or bring, like we bring these protein bars with us, and we usually stop before we get going, setting up at the campsite, and eat something, and then get going. You don't want to get hungry and cranky in the process of backing up and setting things up. It just doesn't start the camping experience off well. So try to arrive well nourished. That's number seven. Number eight is, and I mentioned this a minute ago, is try to set up during daylight. You have enough things on your mind to stress about when you're going out on your maiden voyage. Try not to arrive when it's dark. I mean, you're not going to be able to see things, especially if you get a site that isn't quite level and you've got to put leveling blocks down and do different things to get ready. You know, try to get there during daylight if at all possible. So on your maiden voyage especially, try to plan out a time where you can get to a site when it's daylight. All right, and that's number eight. Number nine, and this is a really important one. It's an expectations thing, leveling your expectations here. Expect construction debris, all right? Every ARPOD we've had, when we've taken it out, the first time you take it on the road, there's all this sawdust in it after, and you're like, what happened? Remember, these are not built to the exacting standards like a new automobile. They're more built like a house on wheels. So you're going to have construction debris. In fact, we had construction debris for several trips on both ARPODs we bought, and you just have to expect that. So bring a little shop vac with you that you can plug in and you know, sweep up the construction debris. But there's going to be some, so just level set your expectations going into it. Don't freak out if you see all kinds of construction debris and sawdust all over the place after your first trip. Okay, so that's number nine. And number 10, once you get there, and I really recommend, go somewhere where you can plug in 30 amp, so not boondocking, plug in just so you can test everything. So you want to plug your 30 amp in, check your electrical, all your lights, check your water, check your furnace, your AC, your appliances, just make sure you go through the whole thing. Try your microwave, convection oven, make sure your refrigerator's working okay. And make sure all your electrical stuff is going well. And if it's not, make a punch list. Because if this is a new ARPOD, it's under warranty for at least the first year if you didn't buy the extended warranty. And so hopefully you bought nearby and you can take it back pretty quickly if you find anything major not going right. I've made punch lists. And by the way, both of my brand new ARPODs have had to go in within a year for some sort of service, some sort of warranty work. So don't expect it to be perfect. I mean, there may be little things that aren't quite right. Make a note of them and make sure you get time with your dealer to get it back in and worked on under warranty. Okay, so those are the 10 things. So what about the bonus tip? So we have one bonus tip that's really important, and we hope to do a video on this by itself for ARPOD 101 level folks in a few weeks, in a month or two, hopefully this summer. And that is, you know, you're gonna be backing in. Now there's two things I think are the most stressful parts of camping. The first one is backing into a site, and the second one is dumping your tanks at a public dump station. All right, those are the two things to me are the most stressful, especially for newbies. You know, the first one, backing in, if you don't know what you're doing, it's very dangerous. We were down at Disney's Fort Wilderness this winter, and we saw a guy, God bless him, he backed in and he hit the pole. I ran over there real quick. His wife was basically just yelling at him the whole time. You know, stop, 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 and he didn't hear, and he kept going and he hit one of the electrical poles. It didn't do much damage to the electrical pole at Disney, but it put a big dent and it pulled the corner of the camper away from the frame. It really messed the camper. It was a brand new camper, unfortunately. So he made a big mistake and he didn't have that backing in down right, and they didn't have good communication between them. So the last tip here is walkie-talkies. All right, walkie-talkies are a great idea because you can talk back and forth, get your communication down with the person who's behind the rig helping you back in, and get good signals down. And again, we're gonna probably do a good video on this later in the summer for you. But walkie-talkies are great. Why not just use your cell phones? The cell phones work great, but what if you're in a place where cell phone reception doesn't work well? You're back to yelling back and forth. So I want to save you that stress in relationship, and getting walkie-talkies may just help save that stress. So think about that. Good idea. So there are the 10 things and the extra bonus tip. Hopefully that's helpful, especially that you guys who are just getting new AirPods, you're getting them out on the road this spring and summer. You know, have a great time. It's a fun, exciting time. And even though, by the way, even though I've had issues with my AirPods, I've loved it. Would do it again in a heartbeat. Love my 179. Going to take it out here in a few weeks and have a good time. But just be aware of some of these things. Hopefully these are helpful to you. And we've really enjoyed making these videos for you and helping you out, especially you guys who are just getting started. So tips for your maiden voyage. Thanks for watching. This is John Marucci, and we appreciate you watching. By the way, if you've enjoyed this video, please give it a thumbs up. And if you ring the bell on the page here, you'll get notified by email every time we got a new video out. And don't forget to hit that subscribe button if you're not a subscriber. We love having you on the channel. Anyway, again, this is John Marucci. Thanks for joining us and have a great day.